Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Wassalatu Wassalamu Alaika Ya Safwat Al-Anbiya'i Wal Mursaleen. Amma ba'd fa'auzu billahi minash shaitani rajim, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qala Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala fil Quran al-Kareem. Wasta'inu bis sabri was salah, wa innaha lakabiratun illa 'alal khashi'in allatheena yazunnuna annahum mulaqu rabbihim wa annahum ilayhi raji'un. Sadaqallahul Azim wa ballaghana rasuluhun nabiyyul karim. Wa qad sadaqta anta ya sayyidi ya sayyidi ya sayyidi ya makki ya madani ya arabi ya qurashi ya hashimi wa ya sayyidana ya sayyidana ya sayyidana يا حبيبنا يا طبيبنا يا حبيب المصطفى المجتبى صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in the previous lecture we talked about the importance of attaining concentration in Salah, the physical form of Salah and the spiritual form of Salah, the body of Salah and the ruh of Salah. And the title given to that lecture was the Metaphysics of Salah. The Metaphysics of Salah, that was the title. And that lecture has already been aired on AIRYQ TV. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we will continue with that. So this will be part two of the Metaphysics of Salah. Just a brief summary of the previous talk. Many people would say that Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْحَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Indeed, the prayer prevents you from sinful acts, from indecent activities, from anything which is impermissible in Islam. The prayer, the salah, prevents you from committing haram. The salah prevents you from committing sinful acts. But people have been praying for such a long time. So and so, my relative, my father, my grandfather, other people that I know, that they offer their 5 times daily prayers in a masjid with jamaat, but they are still sinning. Why are they sinning? When Allah Jalla wa Ala says that the prayer protects you from sinful acts. There we talked about the two types of Salah. One is offering the prayer, and the second is establishing the prayer. Iqamatu salat, establishing salat, and ada of salat, offering the prayer. And we said that the reason behind that is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself answered that. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man lam tanhahu salatuhu anil fahsha'i wal munkar fala salata lah." One whose prayer does not prevent him from sinful acts, there is no prayer for him. He didn't establish his prayer. He may have offered his prayer, but he didn't establish his prayer. So there's a big difference between establishing salah and just offering the prayer. Iqamatu salah. And whenever Allah Jalla wa Ala refers to the mu'minun, the believers in the Quran, Allah Jalla wa Ala does not say that yusalloon, they offer the prayer. Allah says they establish the prayer. Muqimeen. Allah says they establish the prayer. And in this Quranic verse, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْحَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ, when Allah Jalla wa Ala says that indeed the prayer prevents you from fahsha and munkar, the first verse of this Quran is أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ. Allah does not say offer the prayer. Allah says أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ, establish the prayer. And if you establish it, then the prayer will prevent you from sinful acts. So what is establishing the prayer? We talked about establishing the prayer is, it is a combination of two things, the physical form of salah and the spiritual form of salah. The body of Salah and the ruh of Salah. And the body of Salah is to offer the prayer according to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, observing the basic principles of tajweed and studying the fiqh of Salah and implementing the fiqh of Salah during your prayer. That is the body of Salah. Meaning, to pray according to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all the postures in Salah, the ruku, the sujood, the qiyam, the qawma, all of that should be done according to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we must also study the basics of tajweed. And I gave certain examples. For instance, I said that a lot of people think that they are offering their prayer, they're establishing their prayer. I have been praying for many, many years. I know how to establish my prayer. They say this and we tell them to come and study the fiqh of Salah, study the basics of tajweed. And people say, no, I don't have to. Why? I know it all. I have studied with people. I've studied the Quran in Pakistan, in India. I studied with people here in England. So I don't have to study tajweed. I know how to recite it. And you ask them, recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Then they will say, one example I gave, they say, Alhamdulillah. And it's a common practice of people. When we say to people, Assalamu alaikum, how are you, brother? They say, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. So those of you who have studied the basics of tajweed, and those of you who attended our tarbiyah course, They are familiar with the makharij of the huruf. There's a big difference between ha and ha. The letters which are pronounced from the bottom of the throat, huruf halki, middle of the throat, top of the throat, two letters from here, two from the middle, two from the top. So ha is pronounced from the bottom of the throat. And if someone says alhamdu, one of the linguistic meanings of alhamdu is death. It is maut. So you're saying all types of maut is for Allah. Al-ayyazu billah. You're saying all types of death is for Allah. So when we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, we are saying all types of death is for Allah Jalla wa'ala. So it's not Alhamdu, it's Alhamdu. Alhamdu. Also, I mentioned some people say Allahu Akbar. They stretch the Hamza. Ah, Allahu Akbar. And if you stretch it, the Hamza is a Hamzatul Istifham. That means, is Allah the greatest? And if you say, is Allah the greatest, then you are questioning the greatness of Allah Jalla wa'ala, which is a statement of kufr. If you're questioning, is Allah, you want to say Allah is the greatest, but you end up saying, is Allah the greatest? That invalidates the prayer. Also, Allahu Akbar, if you stretch the ba, or if you stretch the hamza before Akbar, Allahu Akbar. So some people, just to beautify their voice, just to recite in a beautiful way, they fail to observe the principles of tajweed. So it's important, brothers and sisters in Islam, for the body of salah to be fully established in the prayer, we study the basics of tajweed and we study with a teacher. We study with a mahir teacher, with a capable teacher who has studied the principles of tajweed before we offer the prayer, before we want to gain the maqam of someone who is a muqeem of salah, who establishes the prayer. And then there are many other principles of fiqh. We mentioned the narration of Sayyidina Huzaifa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that a man was praying for 40 years and he said, how long have you been praying for? He said, I've been praying salah for 40 years. He said, if you have been praying salah for 40 years in this manner, your prayer was not accepted. Not a single prayer was accepted. And according to another narration, if you die like this, you will not die on the deen of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this shows it's important for us to study the fiqh of salah. And if we study the fiqh of salah and implement it and offer the prayer according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then that is the body of salah. And then the ruh of salah is to maintain concentration throughout the prayer. To think about Allahu Jalla wa'ala. To focus in salah. To think about Allahu Jalla wa'ala, to think about what you are saying, to think about being in the presence of Allahu Jalla wa'ala, that I am in the court of Allahu Jalla wa'ala, not to think about dunya. That is the ruh of salah. So if you can maintain concentration throughout the prayer, then you have established the ruh of salah. And the combination of the body and the ruh of salah is a complete prayer. And if you keep praying like that, then that is the prayer that will protect you from sinful acts. Not only sins, it will purify your heart. It will purify you internally, externally. We talked about the physical benefits of salah. We talked about the psychological benefits of salah. We talked about the medical benefits of salah. We talked about how salah protects you from different kinds of diseases. How salah protects you from sinusitis, from fibrositis, from chilblains, from all sorts of skin diseases. We talked about many things, and detailed lectures were delivered about how salah gives you discipline. How salah gives you the ability of making good decisions in life. We talked about various benefits, but that is that salah which is establishing salah, which is iqamatus salah. It is not just praying, just offering the prayer. And that is with the combination of the physical form of salah and the spiritual form of salah, the body of salah and the ruh of salah. And it gives you such a maqam that there comes a time when the salah itself protects you, it guards you, it becomes your bodyguard. The way a bodyguard will guard you against your enemies, the salah itself will guard you against your enemies. So all of that, a detailed lecture was delivered about how to maintain concentration in salah. Now, there are different types of people. When you approach them and you tell them about the importance of salah, some people, they don't have time for the prayer. You know, they just say that, I can't pray salah, I can't, it's not possible for me, it's difficult. Why do they say that? Some people will say, you know, it's for religious people, it's for dindar people, it's for pious people. You know, we are people who are into worldly things, we have a lot of commitments. You know, we have to go to work, we have to go to college, university, we have to raise our children, we have to do a lot of other things. It's impossible, you know, to pray five times daily prayer for a trader, for a worldly person, for a merchant. It's impossible. How can we do it? So that's not true. It's possible. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah will not give you anything which is impossible for you to implement. So salah is possible. And alhamdulillah, the brothers and sisters who are present here, they all offer their prayer. And tonight, inshallah, we have attended this gathering to learn the practical methods of establishing the prayer. Not just offering the prayer, establishing the prayer. How to actually establish the salah. So brothers and sisters in Islam, that's one group of people. The other people are those who find salah difficult, but they try. They try establishing their prayer, but they say it's difficult. We can't wake up for Salatul Fajr. And, you know, they're lazy in their prayer. They don't enjoy their prayer. And today, as it has been advertised, that there comes a time, if you act upon some techniques, some principles that we will be giving today, inshallah, there comes a time in your life, if you keep acting upon them, you fall in love with your prayer. So one is establishing the prayer. If you keep establishing the prayer, the next thing is, you fall in love with your salah. You fall in love with your prayer. To that extent, that the way you feel hungry for food, in the same way you feel hungry for your prayer. Five times daily, every day, you feel the hunger of salah. You can't sleep without salah. You have to offer your prayer. Salah will quench your thirst. But for that, there are some principles. Now, remember, if someone acts upon those things, and if someone enjoys the ruh of salah, then there will be no need of telling that person, that brother, if you don't pray, you will be in hellfire for 28,800,000 years. And the Prophet ﷺ is a mubashir, and Rasulullah ﷺ is also a nazir. Yani Rasulullah ﷺ created fear in people's hearts. But it's not all about creating fear. We talk about this. If you miss your prayer, one prayer, you will be in hellfire for 28 million years. So brothers, let's make a niyyah now. From now on, we will never miss our prayers. Say inshallah. And everyone say inshallah from now on. And then what happens? We make a collective niyyah and everything. But then again, we are still lazy in our prayer. We have problems. Because you can't force people by constantly creating fear in their hearts. You can't just keep doing that. You have to make them enjoy the prayer the way Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made his sahaba enjoy the prayer. And that is something, when you keep acting upon these principles, there comes a time in your life when you feel hungry for the prayer. You can't sleep without the prayer. You feel this pain in your heart. You feel that there's something missing in your life. And then I told you that there comes a time in your life when you're no longer dependent upon the alarm clock. At Fajr time, it is as if a la sha'uri quwwat, as if the prayer itself comes to wake you up. Salah comes, wake up. And there comes a time in your life, if you keep praying your salah according to these principles, you fall in love with the prayer, and then the prayer falls in love with you. To that extent that the Prophet ﷺ says that the prayer itself makes dua for you. Salah makes dua for you. This is not a little thing. What am I saying? The prayer makes dua for you. You know, we make dua with the wasila of the prayer. Ista'inu bis sabri wa salah. When we need Allahu Jalla wa Ala's help, what do? Allah says, seek help through patience and salah. So we seek help from Allahu Jalla wa Ala with the mediation of salah. We offer our prayer, we establish our prayer, and with our prayer, we seek help from Allah. We make dua with the wasila of the prayer. That is a abd. A abd makes dua. A servant of Allah makes dua, calls upon Allah with the wasila of the prayer. Imagine the maqam of the person for whom the prayer makes dua itself. The prayer makes dua for the abd. The prayer gives dua. Salah itself gives dua. Ek to ye maqam hai ki banda namaz ke zariye Allah se dua mange. Uska maqam kya hai jiske liye namaz khud dua mang rahi hai. Namaz khud jise duaen de rahi hai. Ye maqam kaise hasil hota? How do we attain this maqam? For that, there are some principles that we need to act upon. And it's not difficult. It's very easy. It's just that we have to have real commitment. And we have to give a quality time to our salah. Zindagi aamad baraye bandagi, zindagi be bandagi sharmindagi. So in reality, salah is our life. How do you fall in love with the prayer? And why is it that people complain that I don't enjoy my prayer? Prayer is difficult. It's difficult for me to establish my salah. Why is it? Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ عَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُو رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, seek help through patience and salah. وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. Indeed, the prayer is difficult. Indeed, the prayer is difficult. لَكَبِيرَةٌ. But is it difficult for everyone? No. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. But those who have khushu in the prayer. What is khushu? Khushu is a state in which you have true humbleness, true humility, submissiveness, real fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala, true fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Meaning, when you offer your prayer, when you establish your prayer with humbleness, with the fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala, and throughout your prayer, you do not think about dunya, then you are khashi', then you have khushu'. So Allah Jalla wa'ala says, prayer is difficult. وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ. There is no doubt, it is hard for people. It is difficult for people, but it's not difficult for everyone. إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. But those who have khushu. And then Allah Jalla wa'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَزُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. The word zanna yazunnu, one of the meaning of zanna yazunnu, zanna yazunnu gives the meaning of assumption, to assume. Zanantu, I assumed. But it also gives the meaning of certainty. It has an opposite meaning also. So Allah Jalla wa'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَزُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. That who are the people of khushu? Those who have yaqeen that they will soon die. Those who have yaqeen that they will soon meet the Lord. Those who have yaqeen وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, that they will return to Allah Jalla wa'ala. If you can remember the 6.6 general things to think about during the salah to attain concentration in the prayer, the 6 general things to think about, one of them was to have yaqeen that this is the last prayer of my life. Remember that? And I told you at that time, each and every point that I have mentioned to attain concentration in salah and to engage your ruh in the prayer, it is established directly from the Quran and it is established directly from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. And one of the points was to think that this is the last prayer of my life. When you're offering your prayer, you should persuade yourself before the prayer. And even during the prayer, when you're thinking about dunyavi things, remind yourself from praying, Allahu Akbar, Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdika. Then I start thinking about something else. Someone is talking, and then I start thinking about, try listening to their conversation. Then I should remind myself, did I not tell myself that this is the last prayer of my life? Did I not persuade myself that this is the final prayer of my life? When you will think about that, that will give you concentration in the salah. Meaning, this is my last opportunity to persuade Allah Jalla wa'ala to forgive all my sins. After this prayer, I will be in my qabr. If I have offered my Isha and I know that this is the last prayer of my life, when I'm offering my Isha prayer, if I know that this is the last prayer of my life, then I will have yaqeen that I will not be alive till Fajr prayer to ask Allah Jalla wa'ala to forgive my sins. So this is my last opportunity. People who are talking around me, people who are playing or doing things which may divert my attention from the prayer to people, I will ignore them completely. Why? Immediately I will say, this is my last prayer. This is my last. These people may remain in dunya after this, but I will die after this prayer. I will be in maqabr tonight. This is my last opportunity to ask Allah to forgive all my sins. The moment you remind yourself of that, you will have concentration in the prayer. That will give you concentration in salah. That is one of the principles, one of the techniques of learning, of attaining concentration in salah. So, and I have mentioned this in the past, there are 6 general points, and inshallah we will cover them again tonight. So in these 6 general points, one point was to remind yourself that this is the last prayer of my life. And I said everything is established from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. And tonight we have given one Quranic verse for this. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, who are the people who have true khushu? Who are the people who have true fear of Allah? Who are the people? أَلَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Those who have true yaqeen that they will meet the Lord soon. And meeting your Lord is death, isn't it? It is maut. So that is directly established from Quran al-Kareem. You will enjoy your prayer. Prayer will no longer be hard and difficult for you. It will not be a burden for you. Provided that you establish your prayer with khushu. If you start establishing your prayer with khushu, with the fear of Allah, and you engage your ruh throughout the prayer, you're not thinking about dunya. If you maintain that, then there comes a time when you fall in love with the prayer. And then there comes a time when you feel hungry for the prayer. You can't sleep without the prayer. You don't need an alarm clock to wake you up. The prayer itself will wake you up. And that is how you fall in love with the prayer. Now, how do you do that? We will give you the practical teachings for that, inshallah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says, there's a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, لا ينظر الله تعالى إلى صلاة لم يحضر الرجل فيها قلبه مع بدنه. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says, Allahu jalla wa ala doesn't even look at the prayer of a man who does not engage his heart with his body in the prayer. Allah doesn't even look at that prayer. لا ينظر الله تعالى إلى صلاة. Allah جل وعلا doesn't even look at that prayer in which the man does not engage his ruh with his body. Meaning, he's thinking about something else. He does not engage his heart in the prayer. His heart is somewhere else. He's thinking about dunya. Allah جل وعلا doesn't even look at that prayer. And in the past, previous lectures, I have mentioned that that doesn't mean the salah didn't take place. Salah did take place. It doesn't mean that you have to do qaza of that salah. The fardiyya, the fard has been discharged. You have fulfilled the fard. But all the benefits of the salah that have been mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you attain those benefits when you pray, when you offer the prayer, when you establish the prayer with its physical form and the spiritual form. And if you pray with your badan, with your body, but not with the heart, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah doesn't even look at that prayer. لا ينظر الله تعالى إلى صلاة لم يحضر الرجل فيها قلبه مع بدنه. Allah جل وعلا doesn't even look at that prayer. Allahu Akbar. Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu narrates that the beloved of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, when a abd stands for the prayer, when a servant, when a slave of Allah jalla wa ala stands for the prayer, it is as if he is standing right in front of Allah jalla wa ala. He's standing right in front of Allah jalla wa ala. Ma yaliku bi shanihi. Whatever suits his majesty. Now we do not say Allah jalla wa ala is in time and place. He's standing right in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And the moment he does iltifat, the moment he looks around, the moment he thinks about something else, the moment he looks at someone else, Allah Jalla wa Ala says to him, Ya Abd, Ya Ibn Adam. As soon as, now think about it. No, how can we have the audacity to think about someone else when we are standing right in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala? Allah Jalla wa Ala, you are sitting in front of a creation, adna creation, makhluk of Allah, Saqib. You're sitting in front of Saqib and you're reluctant in looking around. And you know that if you look aside, you look around, I'll remind you, you're in a gathering. You should observe the adab of this gathering. Huh? And you will think that I will not like it if you look around because you're not concentrating. Why? You are sitting in a gathering of deen. And you wouldn't want to do that. You would find that disrespectful. But what about the creator of the heavens and the earth? The Prophet ﷺ said, the moment an abd stands in the prayer, he is standing right in front of Allahu Jalla wa'ala. And the moment he looks around or thinks about something else, Allahu Jalla wa'ala says, Yabna Adam, O son of Adam, O son of Adam. Is there anything better in the one that you are looking at than me? Allahu Akbar Kabira. And then what Allah Jalla wa'ala says, Yabna Adam, O son of Adam, I am better for you than the one that you are looking at. And the ulama, the sharihim say, this looking does not mean that you just rotate your eyes or you rotate your head and you look around like that. It means even thinking about someone other than Allahu Jalla wa'ala. That is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The mafhum of a hadith of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. It is a narration of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says that seek refuge with Allahu Jalla wa'ala from the khushu of nifaq. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, seek refuge with Allahu Jalla wa'ala from the khushu of nifaq, from the khushu of hypocrisy, from a hypocrite's khushu. People said, what is the meaning of khushu of nifaq? Meaning khushu, you know what khushu is. To pray, to concentrate, to focus during the prayer, to not to think about dunya, to engage your ruh in the prayer, to have true fear of Allahu Jalla wa'ala, and to pray with humbleness. That is khushu. Now, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala says, seek refuge with Allahu Jalla wa'ala from khushu of nifaq. People said, what is khushu of nifaq? Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala said, khushu of nifaq is that apparently, physically, for someone who's looking at you, he will feel that you have sukoon in your prayer. But in reality, in your heart, there is nifaq. In your heart, there is hypocrisy, there is nifaq. Sayyidina Abu Darda radiyallahu ta'ala narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said that khushu of nifaq is that your zahir jism, your apparent body, it seems that that has khushu in the prayer. But in your heart there is no khushu. In your heart there is no khushu. That is khushu of nifaq. So learn this term, khushu of nifaq. What is that? You know, you are with people and you are praying salah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika wa tabaraka. But you are thinking about dunya. So there are two types of people. One, those who pray in a lazy way. Allahu Jalla wa'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَى يُرَاؤُونَ النَّاسِ. When they stand for the prayer, they stand in a way that lazily, lethargically, like that. That is one type of people. And there's another kind of people which is mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, who have khushu of nifaq. They are the people, they pretend to have khushu in their heart. When they pray, it seems as if they are concentrating in the prayer. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika wa tabaraka smaka. But in reality, they are thinking about someone else. They are thinking about dunya. They are thinking about what they will do after the prayer. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said that this is khushu of nifaq, a hypocrite's khushu. And may Allah protect us from this state. May Allah protect us. This shows that we fear people, but we do not fear Allah Jalla wa'ala. You may think, how is that? How does that mean that we fear people and not fear Allah Jalla wa'ala? Just imagine. Just ask yourselves. Let us ask ourselves that when we pray our salah. Okay, when we are praying in a masjid, in the house of Allah Jalla wa'ala, you offered your four fard with jamaat, and after that you're praying your two sunnahs. And you know that there are people around you. How do you pray when there are people around you? Would it seem as if you're not concentrating in the prayer? Look at the people in the masajid. When people are looking at them, all the onlookers will think that this person is concentrating in the prayer. Your salah, subhanakallahumma bihamdika, everything will be perfect. But compare that to the prayer when you're praying alone in your house, in your room, when no one else is there to see you. You're establishing the prayer in a way. Imagine how you would be praying. Just ask yourselves. I don't have to say that. You know, there may be people who are perfect in their prayer. But a lot of people, when they're praying alone, and suddenly someone comes in. Yes. They're doing ruku and sujood so quickly as if, you know, the dunya is more important. But suddenly, as soon as someone else comes in, they will start concentrating. Is that true khushu? No. This shows that we fear people more than Allahu Jalla wa'ala. We fear dunya more than Allahu Jalla wa'ala. Let alone out of the prayer, even within the prayer, when we are standing right in front of Allahu Jalla Wa'ala, we fear people, but not Allahu Jalla Wa'ala. As if we don't even believe that Allahu Jalla Wa'ala is observing our state. That means that we do not fear Allahu Jalla Wa'ala in reality. And this is what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wa'alaihi Wasallam said, this is khushu of nifaq. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq Allahu Ta'ala said, seek refuge with Allahu Jalla Wa'ala from the khushu of nifaq. Allahu Akbar Kabira. Allahu Jalla Wa'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِكَ هَلُوعًا إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا إِلَّا الْمُسَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. Allahu Jalla Wa'ala says in the Quran, indeed, the humans, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِكَ هَلُوعًا. Indeed, humans are created impatient and greedy. This is the fitrah of humans. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا إِلَّا الْمُسَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. Allah Jalla Wa'ala says, when evil touches them, when evil comes to them, when difficulty in life comes to them, what do? They become impatient. They lose control over themselves. They start complaining. What will happen now? Someone will harm me. This difficulty has come. This hardship of life has come to me. How will I survive? Some loss in their business, they start crying. Impatient. Humans are created. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِكَ هَلُوًا. They're impatient and they're greedy. إِلَّا الْمُسَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. But is that the case with everyone? Is that the state of every human? Allah Jalla Wa'ala says no. But those الْمُسَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. But those who establish their prayers and they are da'imun in their prayers. They are constant in their prayers. Now some of the scholars of Quranic exegesis, they say that da'imun here does not only mean that they are constant in their prayer, they never miss their prayer. They say it gives the meaning of they are constant in engaging their ruh in their prayer. Meaning when they establish their prayer, they do not think about dunya. Throughout the prayer, they have khushu in their prayer. So someone who has real khushu in his prayer, throughout the prayer, then they will not be impatient. You know, being impatient, what is that? That is something very harmful. It harms you, even in your practical life, even in your worldly affairs. It is something, a person who is hasty, a person who makes haste in everything and is impatient, he makes wrong decisions in life. He has no stability in life. And this is why that person will not be successful in his practical life. So to be successful in your life, one of the benefits of having khushu in the prayer, one of the benefits of establishing the prayer with the physical form and the spiritual form of the prayer is that Allah will bless you with success in life, even in your dunya matters. And this mass of shar, Allah Jalla Wa'ala mentioned this in the Quran. وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ الضُّرُّ دَعَانَ لِجَنْبِهِ أَوْ قَائِدًا أَوْ قَائِمًا فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُ دُرَّهُ مَرَّكْ عَلَّمْ يَدْعُنَا إِلَىٰ دُرٍ مَسَّ كَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِلْمُسْرِفِينَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah Jalla Wa'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ الضُّرُّ. When hardship touches a person, وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ الضُّرُّ. When difficulty comes to a person, what does he do? Now ask yourselves, let us ask ourselves, what happens to us? If we are sinful people, if we are committing sins, and suddenly taklif comes to us, what do we do? No matter how sinful we are, we will go to the house of Allah and we will call upon Allah Jalla Wa'ala. There are many people present here. Ask yourself this question. There was a time in life when you were going through a lot of difficulty. Huh? Imagine, compare your state with that state and the state that you are in now. And then understand this Quranic verse. Suddenly you will become Sufi Sahib. The biggest fraudster has become the biggest Haji Sahib. The biggest gangster is the biggest propagator of Islam. The biggest Chaudhary of his mahalla has become the biggest Sufi. What has happened to him? How does that happen? An arrogant man becomes so humble. Allah says, وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ الضُّرُّ دَعَانَا لِجَنْبِهِ أَوْ قَائِدًا أَوْ قَائِمًا فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُ ضُرَّهُ مَرَّ كَأَلَّمْ يَدْعُنَا إِلَى ضُرٍّ مَسَّهُ كَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِلْمُسْرِفِينَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allahu Akbar. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, when difficulty comes to a person, دَعَانَا لِجَنْبِهِ, he starts calling upon us whilst lying down. In all postures, he calls upon us. Allah says, "Oh Qaidan, oh Qaima." He's sitting down, he calls upon us. He's standing up, he calls upon us. He's lying down, he calls upon us. He has a tasbih in his hand. Allah, 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 zikrullah, zikrullah. Oh Allah, save me this time. I promise you, Ya Allah, save me this time. Protect me this time. I will never sin again. I make tawbah, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, protect me. That's what they do. They will be in the first saf in the masjid establishing their prayers. Any lecture, you send them a text message that this lecture is happening, they will be present in the gatherings. They will always be present. Then what does Allah say after that? وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ ضُرُّ دَعَانَا لِجَنْبِهِ أَوْ قَائِدًا أَوْ قَائِمًا فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُ ضُرَّهُ مَرَّ كَعَلَّمْ يَدُونَ إِلَىٰ ضُرٍّ مَسَّ. Allah says, the moment we save them from that trouble, the moment we protect them from that hardship that came to them, مَرَّ كَعَلَّمْ يَدُونَ إِلَىٰ ضُرٍّ مَسَّ. He walks away so arrogantly as if he never called upon us for help. Allahu Akbar Kabira. Allahu Akbar Kabira. Marra ka'allam yaduna ila durri massa. Allah says that he walks away in such a way as if he never called upon us for help. Does he not remember that it is Allah who helped him? And then there comes a time in a human's life. Remember some of these Quranic verses? They were revealed about the evil traits, the evil habits of non-Muslims. But unfortunately, we are observing this in our Muslim community also. And there comes a time if you keep sinning, you will lose your iman. A lot of people think we will always be given a chance. You know, you sin, then you make tawbah, you sin, and some imtihan comes from Allah, some test comes from Allah Jalla wa'ala, we make tawbah. The moment we make tawbah, Allah Jalla wa'ala helps us. When He helps us, when we are protected from that harm, from that difficulty in life, the help comes from Allah Jalla wa'ala, then we stop offering our prayers, we stop establishing our salah. We forget all about Allah Jalla wa'ala. Then another signal comes, another reminder comes from Allah Jalla wa'ala, then we make tawbah. And we keep doing that, and this becomes a constant cycle in a human's life. And we think that we will always be given a chance by Allah Jalla wa'ala. That doesn't happen. That doesn't happen. There comes a time when these signals, they stop coming. And that's the first thing that happens. The first thing that happens, you know, if punishment comes from Allah Jalla wa'ala, you make a mistake and a punishment comes from Allah Jalla wa'ala, that even that is a good sign. That shows that Allah Jalla wa'ala is still testing you. Allah Jalla wa'ala is still testing you. You sin, you commit a crime, and then you lose out. You have a big loss in your business, in your trade. Then you make tawbah. Then Allah Jalla wa'ala saves you. Then you commit another crime. Then another signal, another reminder comes from Allah Jalla wa'ala. So this keeps happening. But there comes a time when it stops happening. Now what is the first sign? What is the first sign? The first sign is Allah Jalla wa'ala stops punishing you in dunya. That's the first sign of the wrath of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Allah stops punishing you in dunya. Meaning there used to be a time when you would sin, you would be punished. A signal would come from Allah. A reminder would come from Allah. Then there comes a time when you stop getting reminders from Allah Jalla wa'ala. There's never a reminder. There's no illness, there's no obstacle, there's no hurdle in your life. You're committing sins and nothing is happening. This is the state when shaitan attacks that person and he makes that person believe now your Lord is happy with you. Remember when you used to sin and something used to happen? Remember when you used to sin, you used to miss a prayer and Allah would punish you? You would look at haram and Allah would punish you? You would tell a lie and a punishment would come from Allah Jalla wa'ala? Remember that used to happen to you? But it has stopped happening. It has stopped happening. Perhaps your Lord is happy with you. Perhaps Allah is happy with you now. And a human begins to think like that. There's nothing wrong with this now. Now I can miss my prayers. The way Allah is saving me here, He will save me and protect me in my qabr. Something will happen. Something miraculous will happen. And there will be no punishment and there will be no accountability for me in the qabr. Do you know what Allah says about these people? Allah says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. There comes a time, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا, people forget the reminders given by Allah Jalla wa'ala. مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ, we used to send reminders. This is Quran, I'm not making this up myself. These are words of Allah Jalla wa'ala. فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. You know, we see people, they're sinning, but they're still successful people. They commit crimes, they're still successful people. They have the best cars, best properties, name, fame, everything. They're sinful people, but they have every luxury of life. They have no difficulty whatsoever. And a lot of simple people, poor people, gharib namazi, gharib ibadat guzar. What do they say? So-and-so is a multi-millionaire. He's a sinful person. But Allah has opened the doors of everything for him. Allah has opened the doors of happiness for him. Why is that happening? People say that, don't they? Listen to this. And those people, you know, you tell them, how are you, Haji Saab? Allah na bada karam hai. Malik na bada hi karam hai. Huh? Namaz wera? Allah maaf kar si. Allah maaf kar si. You know, and you think that they don't really mean it from their heart. They do, deep down in their heart, they know that they are sinful people. But they think this will suffice, this will be sufficient by just saying that Allah's karam, Allah's helping me. The person doesn't pray. Huh? He doesn't establish his salah. He's a criminal. He has oppressed people. He's a zalim. He's a sinful person. A murderer, a qatil, a drunkard, a drug addict, a drug dealer. Whatever he's doing, he knows it. But when you say to him, but he's known as a pious person in the community because he's a successful person. We see that in our community in England, and we see that in Pakistan and India. That's what we see. There are a lot of people, they're very, very famous people. When you approach them, and apparently they may have a tasbih in their hand. Allah's karam, Malik's karam, everything is fine. My Lord has blessed me with everything. And even in his heart he may be thinking, there used to be a time and a punishment used to come from Allah Jalla wa'ala. Now there is no punishment, nothing is happening. So perhaps I am pious. This is the fitna of shaitan. He makes them think, perhaps you are pious. Perhaps you are a good person now. Even though you are sinning, but your Lord is happy with you. Do you know what Allah says? Allah says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, when they forget the reminders that were sent to them, there comes a time. فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. We open the doors of every good thing for them. We open the doors of every good thing for them. They are blessed with everything that they need. They think that the Lord is happy with them. فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكْرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا. Then they start enjoying what they were blessed with. Their properties, their name, their fame, they're enjoying it. They think, my Lord is happy with me. أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. And suddenly Allah Jalla wa'ala holds them accountable. Maut comes to them. Allah takes them. And then there's nothing but despair for them. After that, they will never be given a chance. So brothers and sisters in Islam, these are the evil traits, evil habits of a human that Allah Jalla wa'ala mentions in the Quran. And the first one that I've mentioned, impatient, bi-sabra, has no stability in his life. Is ghair mustaqil mizaj. He doesn't have consistency in anything. Starts one thing, then stops, then starts another thing, then stops doing it. Allah says, this is something which is in the nature. Inna al-insana khulika halu'an. A human is created like that. But brothers and sisters in Islam, if we want to avoid this evil trait, and if we want to purify our hearts from this evil, then Allah Jalla wa'ala says, إِلَّا الْمُسَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَى صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. But those who establish their prayers with complete concentration, who engage their ruh in the prayer, these are the people, they will not be impatient. They will not be hasty people. They will not be people who have no stability in their life. If they make a decision, they will be wisdom in the decision. They will be firasat in the decisions. Who are these people? Those who establish their prayer with the physical form of salah and the ruh of salah. This is that prayer that gives you the haqiqi success. الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَى صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. But those who establish their prayers with complete concentration, who engage their ruh in the prayer, these are the people, they will not be impatient. They will not be hasty people. They will not be people who have no stability in their life. If they make a decision, they will be wisdom in the decision. They will be firasat in the decisions. Who are these people? Those who establish their prayer with the physical form of salah and the ruh of salah. This is that prayer that gives you the haqiqi success. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in another Quranic verse, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Indeed, successful are those people who are khashi' in the prayer. Those people succeeded. Who succeeded? Allah Jalla wa Ala says, those mu'minun, those believers who are khashi' in the prayer, who have khushu in the prayer. So not everyone who prays these five times daily prayers will be successful. Who is successful? And the Mufassirun say, this success is not only success in the hereafter, this is also success in dunya. Allah will bless them with success. Who? The Quran says, those who have khushu in the prayer. This Quranic verse, when Allah Jalla wa Ala created Jannatul Adn. Jannatul Adn is one of the beautiful levels, great levels of Jannah. Beautiful rivers flow under Jannatul Adn. When Allah created Jannatul Adn, Allah addressed Jannatul Adn. And Allah said, O Jannatul Adn, speak. And this is what Jannatul Adn said three times. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Indeed, prosperity is for those who in their prayers are khashi', who engage their ruh in the prayer and fear Allah Jalla wa Ala in the prayers. This was said three times by Jannatul Adn, by one of the great maqams and levels of Jannah. So brothers and sisters in Islam, these were some Quranic verses and a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam about the significance, about the importance of engaging your ruh in the prayer, of engaging your ruh in your salah. Sayyidina Shaykh Shihabuddin Sawardi rahimahullah talks about the linguistic meaning of salah. He says this word salah, sad, lam, the word salah, sallah, yusalli in bab tafil. He says if you look at the root letters of this word, it gives the meaning of fire. Salah denotes the meaning of fire. He says the reason why it's called fire, salah, one of the linguistic meanings of salah is fire. He says that if you place a curled stick, if you put it close to fire, it will make it straight. It will straighten a bent stick. If you place it close to the fire, the heat, the intensity of the fire will straighten it. He says when a believer has a rusty heart, a heart full of filth, and he starts establishing the prayer, the fire of the prayer, meaning the nur of the prayer, will purify his heart. You bring a believer close to the prayer. This is one of the meanings of Sallah yusalli. The Arabs say Sallah al-asa bin nar. That is one of the sayings of the Arabs. Sallah al-asa bin nar. That the fire straightens a stick. So, if you want to be on the straight path, on Sirat-e Mustaqim, then engage your ruh in your prayer and establish your prayer five times daily with da'imun. After understanding the meaning of da'imun, not just constantly praying, since you're taking our time for the prayer, think about your brothers and sisters in Islam. We are taking our time for our salah. From our worldly affairs, from our dunyavi commitments, if you're working or you're in your college or university, it takes you 5 minutes to make wudu, 10 minutes to establish your prayer, that's 15 minutes in every prayer. So that's 1 hour, 15 minutes. Every day you are taking out this time for you to pray your salah. Now this is for those who are praying their salah, but they do not learn their salah, and they do not learn the practical methods of falling in love with the prayer. They do not learn the practical methods of engaging their ruh in the prayer. I'm addressing those people now. Think about it. So many people, they actually read their salah. They take out time for salah, and it doesn't take more time. If it takes you 15 minutes to pray, it will not take you 16 minutes to pray, 17 minutes to pray, not even a minute more than what you're already spending in the salah time, if you act upon these principles, which will make you fall in love with the prayer, which will engage your ruh in the prayer. So since you're actually taking out time, then why don't you try concentrating in the prayer? You are taking out time. You are making that commitment. You are at your workplace, and then from if you're in your university, you will go to your prayer hall and you will go and you will establish the prayer. So since we are taking our time for the prayer, then why do we want to be from those people about whom Allah Jalla wa'ala says they are kusala, they pray lazily in the way that you look at them, you say this lethargic person, look at the way he's standing in the court of Allah Jalla wa'ala. وَإِذَا قَامُوا لَسَّلَاتِ قَامُوا قُسْحَالًا يُرَاوْنَ النَّاسِ. If you are taking, making time for salah, but you're still establishing your prayer to show to other people, يُرَاوْنَ النَّاسِ. So people think that you have khushu in the prayer, alayyazu billah. So if we are making time for salah, let us not think that we can deceive our Lord. Who are you trying to fool? He knows the secret of our hearts. He knows everything that we are thinking about. And if we are praying to please other people, if we keep a roza, we go around telling people I was fasting. If we establish our prayers, we read about tahajjud, ishraq, ibadat, we go around telling people that we are making time. But we think that we can deceive Allah Jalla wa'ala. Let us establish our prayers for the sake of Allah. Only for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And for that, to engage our ruh in the prayer, we have to act upon certain principles. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us begin with the 20 necessary principles for us to engage our ruh in the prayer. Remember, it's not all about what you do during the prayer. To engage our ruh in the prayer, it's not all about what we do during our salah. There are some things we have to do before our prayer, some things during our prayer, some things after our prayer, in order for us to attain complete concentration in our salah. 20 points. And these 20 points, inshallah, I will try to cover some points. First, I will briefly go over the 20 points in salah. And then after going over the 20 points, general meaning of the 20 points, then each and every point we will discuss, inshallah, in this lecture, and in the forthcoming lectures we will complete that. So inshallah, I will just briefly go through all these 20 points, and then I will come back to the first point and I will give examples from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. First is five things to act upon generally when you're not praying your salah. Five things when you're out of salah. Meaning, you prayed your fajr, the time between fajr and zuhr, you need to do five things. So five things to act upon generally when you're not in the state of salah. Five things to act upon during wudu. Take good notes, brothers and sisters in Islam. These are very important points. Five things, everything that we deliver on this platform, it's all practical. We talked about how to raise your children. We gave 20 points. 20 points on that, and alhamdulillah, so many parents are acting upon them. So all these lectures are available on YouTube. You can go and check these lectures. Some parents come to me, my son has become rebellious, and what is the hal for this? I say, I've talked about this in so much detail. The talk in France was a detailed lecture about this. How to raise your children from different umr, from the birth of the child, till he's 2 years old, then 4 years old, then 8 years old, then 10 years old. All of that has been discussed in a lot of detail. And even in that, 20 points were given. Our barnamij of rihla has 40 points. Our daily things that we need to think about every day are 30 points. For children, 20 points. And for concentrating in the prayer and to engage your ruh in the prayer, again, they are 20 points. 5 points, generally to think about when you're not in the state of salah. Five things to work on when you are performing your wudu. Five during azan, and 5 points in salah. Once again, five general things to work on when you're not in salah. Five during wudu. Five things during azan, and 5 during salah when you are offering your prayer. So how many points? 20. First point. First point, generally, mutlaq, when you're not in the state of salah. Consider yourself to be in the state of salah when you're not in the state of salah. That's the first point. Consider yourself to be in the state of salah when you're not offering your prayer. That's the first point. It's very important. We will cover that, inshallah, in a lot of detail. I remember long time ago, a sister from Bedford, she called me and she said, I can't concentrate in the prayer. And a brother, Habib Jami, was driving the car, and I said to her, and I had to talk to someone else on the phone, and I only gave one answer. I said, sister, consider yourself to be in the state of salah when you're not in the state of salah. And then I put the phone down. I said, I have to talk to someone else. Brother Habib started to laugh. He said, that's a good way of getting rid of someone. What does that mean? That doesn't mean anything. What does that mean? Think of yourself being in Salah when you're not in Salah. Is that the answer for to tell someone to gain concentration in Salah? I will explain that in detail today. I told him that day as well, there will come a time and I will go through all the principles of this. Inshallah, tonight, I will give a hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on this. This is a very important point. To think that you are praying when you're not praying. Number two, when you are silent, when you're not talking, you make zikr, pasi and fas. You breathe with the name of Allah Jalla Wala. You breathe in with Allah's name and you breathe out with who. When you breathe in, you say, so when I'm breathing in, I'm saying Allah. When I'm breathing out, I'm saying who. And that you will never get tired with that. Because in order for you to live, you have to breathe. And if you breathe with the name of Allah Jalla Wala, you're not doing anything else. You're just breathing. Yes? So when you're silent, when you're not talking, when you're not reciting the Quran, when you're not saying anything, then you breathe in with the name of Allah and you breathe out with who? And the second thing you do, and that is to purify your heart and purify your mind. The second thing within this, there are two points in this, is that you occupy your mind, you engage your mind in tafakkur. You contemplate, you think. You think about akhirah, you think about your tazkiyah, you think about the purification of the heart, you think about what have I achieved, how many qaza umri are there that I have to do. If I die today, what will happen to me? Will I be held accountable? Will I be punished? Do I have many good deeds or not? So asking yourself and making tawbah, this is called tafakkur. This is called tafakkur. And tafakkur of one moment is better than 60 years of worship. Tafakkur of one moment is better than 60 years of worship. Meaning when you're silent, you're still doing zikrullah. You're still doing ibadat of Allah Jalla Wala. How? You're breathing with the name of Allah. So your breath is occupied in the zikr of Allah Jalla Wala. And even if you get tired with that, then your mind should be occupied in the zikr of Allah. How? Think about the akhirah. Think about your mawt. Think about your daily activities. Think about your progress in your deen. Think about what have I achieved. My tazkiyah, my self-purification. I've closed the gate of my eyes, my ears, my hands. What is my achievement? What have I achieved? Do I feel the nur of tazkiyah in my heart? So thinking about deen, my knowledge, tajweed, fiqh, necessary knowledge of deen, hukukullah, hukukul ibad, am I fulfilling the rights of Allah? Am I fulfilling the rights of the creation of Allah Jalla Wa'ala? The rights of my parents, the rights of my children. Thinking about it. So when we occupy our mind in the fikr of akhirah and fikr of the accountability in the hereafter, that itself is an act of worship. Just imagine that you're not doing anything, you're just thinking. And that is better than 60 years of worship. Thinking for how long? One full day? 1 hour? No, one moment of tafakkur is better than 60 years of worship. One moment of tafakkur is better than 60 years of worship. So when you're silent, you will be doing two things. What's the first one? Zikr-e pasi and fas. You breathe in with the name of Allah, breathe out with who? Allahu, Allahu. And if you get tired of doing that, which you shouldn't do, you know, there comes a time when you will be sleeping. People will be thinking that you're snoring, but you're saying Allahu, Allahu, Allahu. Huh? And this is when you have beautiful dreams, when you have an adat. This takes you, zikr-e pasi and fas takes you into a beautiful world of dreams. You see so many spiritual awliya, anbiya, ziyarat of the malaika and the angels. If you make a habit of making zikr-e pasi and fas. And then before you go to sleep, you practice zikr-e pasi and fas also before you go to sleep. So this is when you're silent. When you're quiet, you make zikr-e pasi and fas. Number three, when you're talking, when you're articulating some words verbally, when you're saying something, when you're doing talaffuz of something, it should either be darood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, recitation of Quran, tasbihat, general litanies and awrad, which we will go through in a lot of detail later inshallah, or beneficial kalam. So one of four things should be happening. Either darood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when you're not saying something, then two things. Either zikr-e pasi and fas or tafakkur. Thinking about the accountability, thinking about your progress. in the spiritual path. And when you are saying something, then it should either be durood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, or recitation of the Quran, or tasbihat, the best tasbihat that we have given. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. And you know the benefits of this. Subhanallah, one tree in Jannah. Alhamdulillah, another tree in Jannah. Another tree in Jannah. Wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. And all the fadail of wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. 7 ahadith were given in the previous Urdu talk about the importance of wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. There are so many benefits. It is a treasure from the treasures of Jannah. This virt, this spiritual litany, وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ الْعَظِيمِ. So all of this is in Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, وَلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ الْعَظِيمِ. All of these are in this. So either darood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, recitation of Quran, tasbihat, or mufid kalam. Before we talk, we ask ourselves, whatever I'm about to say, will that benefit me in dunya or in the hereafter? If the answer is yes, then we will say it. If the answer is no, then we will remain silent. So what are the 4 things? Darood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Second thing? Recitation of the Quran. Third? Tasbihat. Fourth? Beneficial speech. Before we talk, we ask ourselves, is this beneficial in dunya or akhirah? If it is not beneficial in dunya or akhirah, then we will not say it. Point number 4. Practice attaining khushu in the nafal prayers. Practice, do mashq of attaining khushu in the nafal prayers. Offer a lot of nafal prayers. Tahajjud, ishraq, jasht, awabin, all of these nawafil and other extra additional nawafil. Make time for nafal prayers. And in these nafal prayers, one should work on the 6 general things to think about during salah. Imam Ghazali rahimahullah says, if one can force himself to attain concentration in nafal ibadat, the moment he will start his fard ibadah, he will automatically have concentration. So you make yourself majboor in your nafal ibadah. So nafal ibadah is the training. You train yourself during nafal ibadah in attaining concentration. And Imam Ghazali rahimahullah says, if you make yourself majboor, you force yourself to concentrate, you keep doing that in your nafal ibadah, then when you will offer your fard ibadah, your ruh will be engaged in the fard ibadah. Now, in nafal ibadah, 6 things which we have discussed in the first lecture, and again I will advise all the brothers and sisters present here, it's important that you watch that lecture, Metaphysics of Salah, part 1. And in that we discussed all of these points in a lot of detail. Briefly, I will go over these 6 points again. In your nafal, and again at the end we will mention this, but I don't think we will have time to go over this in detail at the end. Next lecture, inshallah ta'ala, we will talk about it in more detail in the light of Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, 6 points. So when you establish your nafal prayer during nafal ibadah, and this is something that we must be doing in our fard ibadah also. It is something to attain concentration in our fard ibadah. These 6 points are necessary. General things to think about during fard ibadah or nafal ibadah. And remember these general things, that's 1 point. That's 1 point. There's 19 more points. It's a lot of people think, because in our little booklets that we have given in the spiritual development booklets, we have given these 6 points. And people think that these 6 points, that's it, it is 6 points. And we have another 14 points. No, these 6 points, that's just 1 point which divides into 6. What is that 1 point? What should you be thinking about generally in the prayer to attain concentration? So this should be practiced in nafal. What is that point? The general things to think about during the prayer, and in the nafal ibadah, we will practice that. What's the first thing? If you can remind me, those of you who were present in this talk, in the last talk, can you remind me what is the first point? Just you, only you know it, Shaib? Oh, 2 people, mashallah. There were hundreds of people in the last lecture. What's the first thing that we should be thinking about, general things during salah to attain concentration? Translation of salah. So we must memorize the translation of salah. First thing to think about, tarjuma of salah, translation of salah. We must know the translation of Salah. I told you, if you go to some famous person in dunya and you want to please that person and he speaks a foreign language, a different language which you do not speak, and you have his name and his titles written on that on a piece of paper and you are reading it, or you have memorized his greatness or his big titles, you have memorized them, but you do not know what you are saying. And if you're going to that king or some prime minister or some famous person or some famous celebrity and you want to please that person and you are praising him in a language which you do not understand yourself, would you please that person? If that person was to know that this person is praising me, but he doesn't even know what he's saying, would he be pleased? No. Imagine being in the court of Allahu Jalla Wa'ala. Imagine being in the presence of the creator of the heavens and the earth. And we have been praying for 40 years and we do not know what At-Tahiyyatu means. We have been praying for 30 years but we do not know the meaning of Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. We are praising Allahu Jalla Wa'ala. We are establishing our prayer and praising Allah. We want to please Allahu Jalla Wa'ala. But we do not even know what we are saying. What kind of salah is that? I'm not saying that salah is not established. I'm not saying that the salah is not performed. I'm not saying that you have to do qaza for that prayer. You have fulfilled the obligatory aqam of salah. You are communicating with the Lord of the heavens and the earth. You are talking to Allahu Jalla Wa'ala. This is your secret conversation with Allahu Jalla Wa'ala. But you do not even know what you are saying. I feel ashamed in asking you to raise your hands up if you know the translation of salah. I remember now there will be a lot of people who will raise their hands up, but I remember in the past there was hardly anyone. How long have you been praying for? 20 years, never missed a prayer. Done all qaza umri. Do you know the translation of salah? No, I don't know what I'm saying to my Lord. I have seen reverts recently become Muslims. And they have learned the translation of Salah. They know the Salah in Arabic and in English. But we are inborn Muslims. Muslims born in a Muslim family. But we do not know what we are saying in our Salah. So the first thing is, brothers and sisters in Islam, we will memorize the translation of Salah. So during Salah, the six general things to think about, the first one is to think about the translation of Salah. Whatever you are reciting, think about its meaning. Think about what you are saying, and that will give you concentration in Salah. Do we make niyyah? Do we make niyyah, inshallah? We will learn the translation of Salah, inshallah. What is the second thing from general things to think about? Imagining that the angels of Allah Jalla Wa'ala are descending from the heavens. This is established from the hadith of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We'll go over that later inshallah in the next lecture. When you say Allahu Akbar, when you establish your prayer, angels come from the heavens. They descend for that person who is establishing his prayer. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, these angels, they surround the person from his feet all around him to the heavens. So one should imagine that the angels of Allah have descended for my prayer, and I'm thinking about dunya during my prayer. So to make yourself alert and to remind yourself that I'm in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala. The second thing is to imagine the angels coming from the heaven. So you think about the translation and you think about the angels of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Third point, what's the third point? You imagine that you are on pul sirat. You think that you are standing on pul sirat, the bridge that all of us have to cross to enter Jannah. So you imagine that bridge which is thinner than a hair and sharper than a sword. And we all have to cross that bridge. On our right hand side is Jannah. On our left hand side is Jahannam. The angel of death is behind us. And we imagine the Ka'batullah is in front of us. We are heading towards Ka'batullah. And the doors of the ma'rifah of Allah Jalla wa Ala are opening for us. Remember this, brothers and sisters in Islam. In Qiyamah, on the day of judgment, we have to cross Pul Sirat. Remember the four questions that everyone will be asked. How did you earn your maal and where did you spend it? Allahu Akbar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a person will be in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala and he will not be able to step forward. He will not be able to move on the day of judgment until he has answered these four questions. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Where did you spend your youth? Jawani kaise guzar? To think about all of these things during your prayer. So what is the third thing? Pul sirat. To imagine pul sirat. Oh Allah, I'm in your court. Oh Allah, I'm offering my prayer today. And I'm thinking about pul sirat. How will I cross pul sirat on the day of judgment? And you think that I'm standing on pul sirat. On my right hand side is Jannah. On my left hand side is Jahannam. Behind me is the angel of death. And according to some scholars, you think that the angel of death is above your head. In front of you is Ka'batullah. You're heading towards Ka'batullah. And the doors of the ma'rifah of Allah Jalla wa Ala are opening for you. And you're standing on that pul sirat, which is thinner than a hair and sharper than a sword. And the moment you will slip, and slip is slipping of mind. The moment you think of dunya, just imagine I'm about to fall in Jahannam. What am I doing? I'm on my musalla. I'm in the court of Allah Jalla wa Ala. I cannot afford to fall in Jahannam. I will concentrate in the prayer. That's the third thing. So what's the first thing? Translation. Second, imagination of what? Angels of Allah Jalla wa Ala descend. Third, pul sirat. Fourth thing is to persuade yourself that this is the last prayer of my life. Constantly remind yourself that this is the last prayer of my life. I talked about it earlier. If a medical doctor tells you, if your physician tells you, you're about to die, you only got 3-4 hours to live, and you are praying your Maghrib prayer or Isha prayer, and you know that this is the last prayer of your life, imagine the level of concentration you will have in that prayer. No matter what people are doing around you, you will not worry about it. People are laughing, playing, doing whatever things that can divert your attention. You will say, this is my last opportunity to persuade Allah to forgive me. How can I think about dunya? I will be in my qabr tonight. So when shaitan attacks you during your salah, when shaitan makes you think about different things, the first thing, think about translation. If shaitan makes you think about something else, remind yourself that the angels are descending. What are you doing? I'm praying. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Okay, what will I do today? Saqib, wake up! Look at the angels! Angels are descending for you! You're offering your prayer! And you're thinking about dunya? Okay, that will give me a bit of concentration. Then after that, shaitan will attack me again. I think, what are you doing? You are on pul sirat. So it's not that you have to think about all six things. You can just focus on one thing. Some people will gain concentration with translation only. Some with the angels. And then some with thinking, constantly reminding themselves that this is the last prayer of my life. And if in one prayer you can think of all six, that's fine. One point in the beginning, second point in the middle of the prayer, third point. This is something that has been practically implemented by thousands of people, alhamdulillah, all over the world. And they are blessed with the nur of the prayer. This is what makes you hungry for the prayer if you start acting upon these principles. So what was that point number four? That was point number four. To think that this is the last prayer of my life. Point number five. What's point number five? To imagine. If you can't imagine that you're seeing Allah Jalla wa Ala, then you imagine that Allah can see you. But people say that's difficult. We can't see Allah. We can't imagine Allah. Allah does not have a physical form. So we cannot imagine Allah. The ulama say, you can't imagine Allah. You can't see Allah. You can't think about Allah Jalla wa Ala. Then you should think that you're looking at the name of Allah. Can you see the name of Allah? Can you imagine the name of Allah Jalla? We can all imagine the name Allah, Hamza, Lam, Lam, Ha, Shadda. Yes? You can all imagine that. The ulama say that you should focus on the name of Allah during Salah. This is Kanzul Huda, what I'm telling you. Kanzul Huda, treasure of true guidance. These principles, you will not get them anywhere else in the world. Huh? Kanzul Huda gives you this. So you imagine the name of Allah in front of you and you focus on the name of Allah. You look at the names. You can't see Allah, you can see the name of Allah. You can imagine the name of Allah. That's number five. And then number six, the sixth thing is to imagine the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli." Pray in a way that you are seeing me pray. So you imagine the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine the beautiful zulfa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine the beautiful qiyam of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine the beautiful ruku of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And keep reminding yourself that, do I have the ability? Do I deserve this? Do I deserve to be on the same musalla as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? My form of communication with Allah is the same as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Bayimana, in the meaning that I am reading namaz, the same namaz as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do I deserve this? And if I'm blessed with this opportunity, I will enjoy the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To think about the salah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To think about the ruku of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sujood of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the sixth point. So these six points, you do mashq of these six points during nafal. During nafal ibadah, you practice these six points. And Imam Ghazali rahimahullah says, if you can force yourself of thinking about these six points, if you can force yourself to concentrate in your nafal prayer, then that will automatically give you concentration in your fard prayer. That was point number four. Point number five is to remain in the state of wudu at all times, all the time. Remain in the state of wudu all the time. And before going to sleep, making sure that you're in the state of wudu and you think about the Fajr prayer. When you go to sleep at night, you make sure that you're in the state of wudu. So what is, these are five points. Remember, our ulama say that wudu itself is a protection against sins. And the one who remains in the state of wudu, wudu is a shield. Wudu is a protection against sins. And if you will stay in the, remain in the state of wudu, wudu itself will purify you. So to remain in the state of wudu, that is point number five. So once again, point number one, in external things, to consider yourself to be in the state of salah when you're not in the state of salah. Yes? Number two, when you are quiet, you're doing two things. Zikre pasi and fast. Or you're thinking, tafakkur, tafakkur of akhirah, fikr of akhirah. Number three, when you're saying something, when you're reciting something or you're talking, you're either reciting darood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Second, reciting the Quran. Third, tasbihat. Fourth, beneficial kalam. So that was point number three, which divides into four types. Point number four, practice concentrating in salah during your nafal prayer. And force yourself, make yourself majbool to think about one of these six things in nafal prayer, and that will give you concentration in the fard prayers. Number five, remain in the state of wudu. These are general external things when you're not in salah to act upon. How many? Five things. Now next five, during wudu, what are the things that you act upon during wudu? Remember our ulama have said, Sheikh Shihabuddin Sarwardi rahimahullah says, the one who can concentrate in wudu will be blessed with concentration in salah. The one who can concentrate in wudu will be blessed with concentration in salah. A lot of us, we think wudu is just an external thing because we think that it is a key for the prayer. It is not an act of worship. And we think that we'll just make wudu. That's why people make wudu. You go and you make wudu and you think about your salah. We think salah is important. Wudu is not important. Remember, wudu has its significance. Wudu has its importance. Wudu is that which purifies you. Wudu is an external tazkiyah and it is also an internal tazkiyah. And the one who can concentrate in wudu will automatically gain concentration in salah. What are the five points in wudu? The first one, Subhanallah. In wudu, you keep reminding yourself that this is the last wudu of my life. That's the first point.
Remind yourself that this is the last wudu of my life. Wudu itself is something that we have to enjoy. We have to enjoy your wudu. When you wash your face, just imagine the nur that is created. And think that this coolness of the water that I'm being blessed with today, I will never be blessed with this after this. This is my last opportunity to perform wudu. That's the first point of wudu. Second, before wudu, you recite Bismillahi walhamdulillah. You recite Bismillahi walhamdulillah. And during wudu, you recite all the du'as of wudu. And after completing the wudu, you recite the du'as of wudu, which we will give in the next lecture, inshallah. So what's the first thing? Reciting Bismillahi walhamdulillah. You know the fadila, the benefit of that. If you recite Bismillahi walhamdulillah before wudu, then until you remain in the state of wudu, the angels of Allah Jalla wa Ala, they continuously write good deeds in your account. That is for who? For the one who recites Bismillahi walhamdulillah before wudu. Until you will remain in the state of wudu, the angels of Allah Jalla wa Ala will continuously write good deeds in your account. And not only that dua, during wudu, the duas during wudu, and the duas after completing wudu. That is point number two. Point number three, to make wudu according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everything in Sharia, everything that we need to act upon, study my book, Kanzul Fiqh. In that, the chapter of wudu is very clear. It goes through all the practical method of wudu, the sunnahs of wudu, the mustahabbat of wudu. Do wudu according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. That is point number three in wudu. Point number four, this has four points. One, to create the fear of Allah jalla wa ala during wudu. Fear Allah during wudu. To create hope of Allah during wudu. That's point number one. Number two, when you're washing your face during wudu, think about the sins of the eyes leaving your body. The sins of your eyes are being washed away. All the sins which are committed by the eyes, by the face, anything, any sin that is committed by the eyes, the face, the lips, all of these sins are being washed away. You're being purified. And also you think that, oh Allah, today with the blessing of this wudu, because the Prophet said this. This is a hadith of Rasulullah. In the light of a hadith, we will go through in a lot of detail, inshallah. We'll explain that later. But you should imagine that my sins are being removed with the water. Remember Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, in Al-Mizanul Kubra, Imam Abdul Wahhab Sha'arani rahimahullah mentions, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was blessed with this karama. Once he went to a masjid of Kufa. In the masjid of Kufa, he saw a young person making wudu. And as I said, that when you make wudu, when you wash those parts of the body which are to be washed in wudu, then the wudu will purify you from the sins committed by that limb of the body. And that those sins, they leave the body. They remove from the body with the water of wudu. Imam Azam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he saw a youngster making wudu. And he looked at his wudu water. And he said, make tawbah from disrespecting your parents. Allama Abdul Wahhab Sha'arani rahimahullah said, the youngster made tawbah. Then Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah saw another youngster in the masjid of Kufa who was making wudu. He looked at his water, the water of wudu. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah said, make tawbah from committing zina. Meaning you're a fornicator, you're a zani, make tawbah. He made tawbah. Another person Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah saw, he was making wudu. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah looked at that and he said, make tawbah from drinking khamr. And make tawbah from haram musical instruments. And he made tawbah. That is the day when Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he asked Allah Jalla wa Ala to take this kashf away from him. This was a karama of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. But he did not want to know the sins of people. So he asked Allah, he made dua. Oh Allah, take this kashf, take this karama, take this miracle away from me. I no longer need this karama. I do not want to be aware of the sins of people. And that is the day after that he could not see the sins of people who were performing wudu. This is one of the karama of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. So remember, when we make wudu, when you wash your face, the sins of the eyes are removed. When you wash your hands, the sins of the hands, they live with the water of wudu. When you wash your feet, the sins of the feet. When you wash your, when you make mas around your ears, then the sins of the ears. are removed. And this, remember, these are the minor sins. They are not major sins. For major sins, you have to make tawbah. And that tawbah is included in this wudu. So you have to make tawbah from all the sins. So when you're making wudu, when you wash your face, you think that the sins are leaving from my eyes, and then you make niyyah. Oh Allah, I make niyyah that I will make the tazkiyah of my eyes. From this day forth, I will not look at haram. You make tawbah. This is how you perform wudu. This is how you create the fear of Allah Jalla wa Ala during wudu. This is how you start enjoying your wudu. Tell me, have you ever done this before? Have you ever heard of this before? You've been attending lectures for many, many years. Have you ever heard these points before? Yes, you might have heard them, but nowhere else. In Kanzul Huda. In Kanzul Huda. Some people, some scholars or ulama, they know these points. But generally these things are not talked about in our gatherings. Unfortunately, we are deprived of these spiritual teachings of the awliya. They are all there in the books. And this is why our community is deprived of these barakat. This is why we don't fall in love with salah. This is why we do not feel hungry for the prayer. So, when you wash your hands, you think about the sins leaving the hands and sins of the hands, the minor sins committed with the hands to be forgiven, and then you make an intention. Oh Allah, I will purify my hands. Meaning, I will do tazkiyah of my hands. I will not use my hands to oppress people. I will not use my hands to touch something which is haram. I will not use my hands to point at something which is haram. I will not use my hands, my fingers to send text messages to someone which is haram. I will not use my hands on Facebook and commit haram with my hands, with my fingers to contact sisters and to commit haram. Allah Ya Zubillah, you make tawbah of all of these when you make wudu. This is the tazkiyah of the hands. So one is you imagine, you think of the sins leaving your hands. You think of the sins being forgiven. And the second thing is, you make tawbah and you say, oh Allah, I make tawbah that I will not sin with my hands. When you rinse your mouth, you think of making niyyah. You make niyyah of not eating haram. That is when you clean your mouth, when you rinse your mouth. When you make mas over your head, one quarter of your head or full head, when you make mas, you think about, Ya Allah, today the sins of my mind are being purified. Today the sins of my mind are being forgiven. I make niyyah. From this day forth, I will not think about evil. I will not think about haram. This is the tazkiyah of the mind. This is what wudu is. Wudu is an external purification and it is also an internal purification. When you clean your nose, when you put water in your nose, what is that? Why do you clean your nose? Do you know why you clean your nose? You make niyyah that I will not be nosy. Do you know that? You know nose, a koji. Or a dog uses his nose, a sniffer dog. What does he do? How does he detect? How does he follow people to know the whereabouts of people? A dog will use its nose to know the whereabouts of people. So why do we clean our nose? These are the hikmahs of wudu. Why do we clean our nose? We make niyyah. Oh Allah, I will not be like a dog, knowing about the weaknesses of people. So and so, where is he? Who is he talking to? What is he doing? What is he doing in dunya? What is he doing in deen? Did he commit a crime? Is he a sinful person? Is he a liar? Is he an arrogant person? What has he done in deen? What has he done in dunya? Ya Allah, make niyyah from all the sins of the nose. I will not be nosy. Huh? So you, this is when you clean your nose, you think about, I will not be a koji. You know koji, a detector? In our countries you have a koji, he goes around looking for people. I will not be like that. You make tawbah from the sins of your nose. That's why the nose is clean. You know when we will talk about the philosophy of Islamic legal system, in that we will talk about the benefits of cleaning the nose. Medical benefits of cleaning the nose. But this is something that we will think about when we will make wudu. So, also the feet. So everything which is washed, you think about the sins and you make tawbah. One is you imagine the sins leaving your body. And the second thing is you make tawbah from committing those sins. And next point, in this point number four, you imagine the nur increasing. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, a mu'min on the day of judgment will be recognized by Rasulullah ﷺ with the nur created by performing wudu. So when you wash your hands on the day of judgment, your hands will shine. Your hands will be lit on the day of judgment. Your hands, your face will be lit on the day of judgment. It will be illuminated. There will be a nur, a khas nur created with the asr of wudu. So you imagine, Ya Allah, this is my last opportunity to increase the nur of my face, to increase the nur of my hands, to increase the nur of my feet, to increase the nur of my head, to increase the nur of my ears. So you imagine the nur increasing when you perform wudu. And that's when you enjoy the wudu. Huh? So when you concentrate in wudu, you will automatically gain concentration in salah. So this was point number four. Point number five in wudu is that you perform the two nafil of tahiyyatul wudu. Two nawafil of tahiyyatul wudu, you perform them. That is point number five. So how many points have we covered? 10 points. And remember, this is just a general explanation. Each and every point, we will discuss that in the light of ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Everything is in the light of Quran and the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how many points have we covered in wudu? Five. Altogether, how many points have we covered? 10 points. MashaAllah. Excellent.
Next. Azan. What should you be thinking about during azan? The first thing, the moment you hear the words of azan, it should create happiness in your heart. And that's a tester for us whether we are mu'minun or not. One of the signs of a hypocrite is, a hypocrite when he hears the words of azan, azan is a burden upon his heart. So, to feel excited about it, to feel happy about it, you know, this lehr is a streak of happiness should flow through our veins, through our body, when we hear the azan. And if you can't hear the azan, then use all the apps which are available on the phone for an alarm or for a reminder, which can remind you for the prayer. And when you hear that, even if it's not an azan, if it's just an alarm, if it's just a reminder, then by that reminder, we should ask ourselves, are we feeling the happiness in our hearts when we hear the words of azan? If not, then create that happiness. The first thing is, create happiness. Feel excited and happy about azan. Number two, for azan. When you hear the azan, create the fear of Allah in your heart. The first thing is, happiness. The salah time has started. I'm about to present myself in the court of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And the second point is, when you hear the azan, create the fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala in your heart. Khawf of Allah Jalla wa'ala. What kind of fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala? You imagine that this great trust, this great amana has been given to me. I have been blessed with this great trust in the form of salah. Will I be able to do justice with it? Do I deserve this? Will I be able to do justice with salah? Oh Allah, this great trust, amana has been given to me in the form of salah. And I am going to present myself in your court, Ya Allah. Will I be able to do justice? With that concept, with that imagination, create the fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala in your hearts. That is point number two in azan. Point number three, give jawab of all the words of azan and iqamah, and recite the dua of wasila after azan. There is so much reward in that. So much reward in that. You'll be amazed when you hear the reward of this. I don't have the time to cover the reward of that at the moment. Inshallah, that's in the next lecture. We'll go through all the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Azan, the words of Azan. When Allahu Akbar is said, you say Allahu Akbar after it. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. And all the words, there's some other words that you have to add. So to read, to repeat the words of Azan, Ikama, and also Ikama. Remember, a lot of our people, they read Ikama. How do they read Ikama? Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Remember, there is no doubt that Ikama is read. It's not read like Azan, but it shouldn't be read that fast the way people read. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. No. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Like that.
So people can repeat it. Give time to people so that they can repeat the words of Ikama. So repeat the words of Azan and repeat the words of Ikama and recite the dua of Wasila after Azan. And then, after reciting the dua of Wasila, make this dua. O Allah, I beg you, bless me with khushu in my prayer and accept my prayer. You make this dua. So after Azan, we make this dua. First is we recite the words of Ikama and Azan, then we read the dua of Wasila, and then we say, O Allah, bless me with khushu and khudu, with complete concentration in the prayer, and Ya Allah, accept my prayer. This dua is important. We can't do this ourselves. We cannot attain concentration in the prayer with our own efforts. Remember, it all happens with the karam of Allah, with the fadl of Allah. Why are we here today? We are sitting here to feel hungry for the prayer. We will implement these principles so we feel the thirst of salah. We will implement these principles so we feel hungry for salah. The way you can't sleep without eating. The way you cannot sleep without drinking. If you don't eat, if you don't drink, you feel a lot of pain. That's why we are here. To create, to search for sukoon in salah. And if we act upon these things, then we will fall in love with the prayer. And we don't have to do anything else. Most of these things are recitation and things in our mind. We don't have to go to places to do things. There's nothing additional. As I said, if it takes you 15 minutes to pray, then it will not take you longer than 15 minutes. If you spend 1 hour 15 minutes daily in your 5 times daily prayers, it will not take you 2 hours. It will still take you 1 hour 15 minutes to pray. But the benefit of acting upon these is that you will fall in love with the prayer. And your salah will give you du'as. Your salah will give you du'as. Subhanallah. Number 5. After Azan, with all the adab of masjid, observing all the adab of masjid, immediately go to the house of Allah and sit in the house of Allah whilst observing all the adab of the masjid. Do not talk about dunya. Do not talk about worldly matters in the masjid. Do not laugh in the masjid. Observe all the adab. That is a big sin. This is unfortunately another problem in our communities. People go to the masjid, they treat it as a community center. They sit together and talk about all the politics of the world in the house of Allah Jalla wa'ala. One is politics of Pakistan, politics of England. Then there's another politics. The politics of the committee of the masjid. That's another siyasat. There's another medan of siyasat in the masajid. So to avoid all of that. To observe all the adab of the masjid. So these are the 5 points of Azan. Finally, the 5 points, 5 internal points during salah. First one. To establish the prayer with the physical form of the prayer, with all the zahiri arkan of salah, according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Meaning, to fulfill the ahkam of the body of salah. Remember the point of the body of salah? That is the first point. First internal point of salah. Second point, the tartib of sufuf, the saf, the rows, to straighten the rows of salah. That is the responsibility of the imam. And we will discuss that in a lot more detail later, inshallah. Point number three are the 6 points. What are the general things to think about during salah? 6 points. You know the 6 points that we studied earlier? That is point number 3. That is point number 3. General things to think about during salah. The 6 points. To work on the 6 points. Last prayer of my life. Translation of salah. Standing on pul sirat. And then? Looking at the name of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Imagining the salah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is point number 4. Point number 5.
After completing the prayer, making tawbah from the sins. After completing the prayer, making tawbah from sins and reading the du'as after the prayer. As I said, in the future lectures, we will go through all these du'as. But to make tawbah, because with the prayer, all the minor sins will be forgiven. With the wudu, the minor sins will be forgiven. So once you've completed the prayer, then you make tawbah from all the sins of the past. Pran, P, accepting the sins that you have committed in the past. I'tirafu zam, acceptance of the sins that you've committed in the past and making tawbah from the sins of the past. R stands for? P stands for past. R stands for?
Remorse.
R stands for?
Remorse.
R stands for?
Remorse.
P stands for?
Past
sins. R stands for?
Remorse.
A stands for?
Remorse.
Allah's sake. And N stands for?
Never
again. Pran. I repent from the sins of the past. Oh Allah, I'm ashamed of my sins. Oh Allah, I only do tawbah for your sake, Allah's sake. And never to sin again. Never to sin again. So you make tawbah from the sins of the past with the four prerequisites of tawbah. And then we read all the du'as, the necessary du'as which will be given in the future lectures. And then after that, the third point, the third juz of point number 5 is we create this desire that Ya Allah, from this prayer, if I have offered Zuhr, Ya Allah, from Zuhr till Asr prayer, I will wait impatiently for Asr prayer. In anticipation for Asr prayer. Ya Allah, I will wait impatiently for Asr prayer. Anxiously, with eagerness, yearning for the time of Asr to enter. You make this niyyah. That is the 20th point. So how many points are there? Five points when you're not in Salah. 5 points in wudu, 5 points in azan, and 5 points internally when you are in salah. Today we will only cover the first point, and it's dalail in the light of a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is the benefit of thinking of yourself being in the state of salah when you are not in the state of salah? The first point in the light of ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is called intizarus salah, waiting for the next prayer time to enter. Intizarus salah, waiting for the time of salah to enter. That itself is as if you are in the state of salah. So when, once you've prayed your zuhr, from zuhr prayer till asr, constantly remind yourself, I'm waiting for Asr, I'm waiting for Asr. Thinking about Asr prayer, thinking about the prayer, the next prayer. And that thinking of the next prayer itself is as if you are praying, as if you are in the state of Salah. Subhanallah. Sayyiduna An ibn Abi Awfa radiyallahu ta'ala an anna an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wasallam qala inna khiyar ibadillahi allazina yura'una ash-shamsa wal-qamara wan-nujuma li dhikrillah rawahu Tabarani wal-Bazzar wal-Hakim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the best of people are those who keep an eye, who consider and observe the sun and the moon and the stars. That's a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The best of people are those who consider. Remember, the times of Salah were determined by looking at the sun, the stars and the moon. In olden days when we didn't have the facility today that we have, the watch, the timetables, all of this that we have. In them days, what did they used to do? They used to look at the stars. They used to look at the moon. They used to look at the sun. And that's how they used to determine the time of Salah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam said, the best of people are those who keep an eye on the stars, the sun and the moon. Why? For the prayer. They wait for the prayer. They are the best of people. The best of people. Now in this day and age, how do you do that? How do we do that? Once you prayed your zuhr, for example, after zuhr, you keep a timetable with you. Keeping a timetable for Salah with you and constantly, when will Salatul Asr start? Waiting for Salatul Asr. Everything in your life revolves around your prayer. Not that the prayer revolves around your daily activities. Everything in life should be around the prayer. Everything that we should do, it should be based on Salah. When you have a meeting with someone, what should you say? Rather than saying, brother, I will meet you at 11 a.m., you say, I will meet you at 11 a.m. before Zuhr prayer. If you have to meet someone at Maghrib, rather than saying, If you have to meet someone, just say at 4 o'clock, 4 p.m. Rather than saying 4 p.m., say, brother, I will see you at 4 p.m. before my evening prayer. And that is something that we should say to Muslims and non-Muslims. This is a da'wah. It is a form of da'wah. When you speak to a non-Muslim friend, you will introduce your 5 times daily prayers by just talking about the prayer and by just discussing your schedule. I will meet you at night. What time? I will meet you at 7 p.m. after Isha prayer. After my Isha prayer. What is the reward of that? This is as if you are looking and keeping an eye on the sun and the moon and the stars. Meaning your entire life revolves around your prayer. Not that you decide, you make decisions about your meetings, and then the prayer follows your worldly affairs. No, the worldly affairs follow your prayer. For you to be the best person. The best of people. Who are the best of people? Who keep an eye on the sun, the moon and the stars. This also includes, if you need to catch a bus to go somewhere, when you buy the ticket, you think, where will the bus stop? Train, aeroplane, where will it land? Where will I pray my Zuhr? Where will I pray my Asr? To consider the prayer, to think about the prayer before buying a ticket, you will get the reward, such a reward of being the best of people. The best of people, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In this day and age, this is how you do it. And what is the benefit of that?
عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال صلينا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المغرب فرجع من رجع وعقب من عقب فجاء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مسرعا قد حفظه النفس قد حسر عن ركبتيه قال أبشروا هذا ربكم قد فتح بابا من أبواب السماء يباهي بكم الملائكة يقول انظروا إلى عبادي قد قضوا فريدة وهم ينتظرون أخرى رواه ابن ماجة.
Ibn Majah narrates this in Kitab al-Masajid, Bab al-Luzum al-Masajid. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala narrates, Sallayna ma'a Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, we offered our Maghrib prayer with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. فَرَجَعَ مَنْ رَجَعَ وَعَقَّبَ مَنْ عَقَّبَ. Some people remained in the masjid and some people left from the masjid. He said, suddenly the Prophet ﷺ came in the masjid. And Rasulullah ﷺ entered in a masjid very hastily. And the Prophet ﷺ was breathing heavily. In a way, he said, he came so fast in the masjid that the Prophet ﷺ was holding his lower garment. And the lower garment was almost uncovering the knees of Rasulullah ﷺ. This is how quickly the Prophet ﷺ came in the masjid. And why was Rasulullah ﷺ entering in the masjid in such a way? Why did the Prophet ﷺ came so fast in the masjid in the house of Allah Jalla wa'ala? Rasulullah ﷺ said to the Sahaba, Abshiru, Abshiru. Rasulullah ﷺ said, there's a great news for you people. Be happy, express your happiness. There's a great news for you people. What is the news for the people? Rasulullah ﷺ said, O people, listen, your Lord has opened one of the doors of heavens. One of the doors of heaven has been opened by Allah Jalla wa'ala. And do you know what Allah Jalla wa'ala is doing? Yubahi bikumul malaika. Allah Jalla wa'ala is praising you with pride to his angels. Allah Jalla wa'ala is praising all of you people with pride to his angels. And do you know what Allah Jalla wa'ala is saying? Allah is saying, O angels, look at these people. They have discharged one obligation and they are waiting for the next one. Allahu Akbar Kabira. These are the people who offer one prayer and after completing that one prayer, they wait in anticipation for the next prayer. They wait for the next prayer. What happens? You are waiting in the house of Allah for the next prayer to enter. Allahu Jalla wa'ala, yubahi bikumul malaika. In his own court, Allahu Jalla wa'ala, in the presence of his angels, he praises you with pride. He says, look at these people. Oh angels, look at these people. And the Prophet ﷺ came very hastily. Rasulullah ﷺ came running in the masjid. To that extent that the narrator says, Rasulullah ﷺ came so fast that his lower garment was almost uncovering his knee. And Rasulullah ﷺ was breathing heavily. And Rasulullah ﷺ, out of immense happiness, the beloved ﷺ said, Abshiru, Abshiru, Abshiru. There's a great bashara. There's a great news for you people. Be happy. What is the news? Allahu Jalla wa'ala is praising you with pride. Yubahi means to boast about something. To boast about something to his angels. And what is Allah saying? Look at these people, O angels. They have fulfilled one fard, they have discharged one obligation, and they are waiting for the next one. That is the fadila of waiting for the next prayer. Waiting for the next prayer. This is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Take another hadith. And remember, the ulama say that if someone remains in the house of Allah, will gain maximum reward. And if someone does not remain in the house of Allah jalla wa ala, and he is engaged in worldly affairs, but his heart is engaged in the remembrance of the prayer. He has offered his zuhur prayer, but he's thinking about asr. He's thinking about asr. What time will asr enter? He's constantly, his ruh is engaged in the remembrance of the following prayer. His body is engaged in his worldly affairs, but his heart is engaged in the remembrance of the following prayer. It is as if he is in salah. It is as if he is in salah. As if he is praying his salah. This is what the ulama say. Even if he is not in the masjid, he leaves the house of Allah, but he doesn't, his heart doesn't leave the house of Allah. His body leaves the house of Allah, but his heart doesn't leave the house of Allah. It is as if he is in salah. That is the reward for the one who waits for the next prayer and constantly thinks about the next prayer. Next hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, an Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala an, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, la yazalu ahadukum fi salatin, ma damatis salatu tahbisuhu, la yamna'uhu an yanqaliba ila ahlihi illa as-salah. Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says, the one who waits for the following prayer and nothing prevents him from going to his house, nothing stops him but the prayer itself. It is only the prayer for which he remains in the house of Allah Jalla wa Ala. The one who waits for the prayer is in the state of the prayer. That's hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one who waits for the next prayer, it is as if he is praying, as if he is offering his salah. This hadith, Imam Bukhari narrates this. أخرجه البخاري في كتاب الأذان باب من جلس في المسجد وأخرجه مسلم في كتاب المساجد باب فضل صلاة الجماعة. Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari both narrate this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a sahih hadith, meaning the one who waits for the next prayer, it is as if he is praying. So this itself is another salah. Can you imagine this, brothers? 24 hours throughout the day you are in the state of salah. Now do you understand what I meant by when I said, consider yourself, Habib Jami, when I said that, think that you are in the state of salah when you are not in the state of salah. You won't laugh at that now, would you? This is proven from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Consider yourself to be in the state of salah when you are not in the state of salah. You are not praying, but you are still praying. Subhanallah. The ulama say, why do you have to do that? Do you know, even, no matter how sinful a person is, when he is praying salah, no matter how sinful a person is, when he is reading salah, he would not sin. He would not sin. Why? Because he thinks that he is in the presence of Allah Jalla wa Ala. In salah, a believer, a Muslim will not sin. He will not sin because he says, I'm in the court of Allah, how can I sin? So when you begin to think that you're in salah when you're not in salah, then even then you will not sin. You will think I'm reading namaz. The way in namaz you will not sin, when you consider yourself to be in namaz, when you're not in namaz, then even then you will not sin. Because you will think, Allah Jalla wa Ala is observing me. I'm praying. I'm in salah. And what places you on the musalla? What places you on the musalla spiritually, on a spiritual musalla? Is just thinking about the prayer. Waiting in anticipation for the prayer. Anxiously waiting, impatiently waiting, yearning for the time of salah to enter. When will the time of salah enter? Huh? And when we talk about the azan, then I will tell you what that excitement is all about. These are the points that will make you fall in love with the prayer. These are the points when you act upon them, you will feel hungry for the prayer. Subhanallah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this person will be in the state of salah even though he is not praying, even though he is not praying, but because he is waiting for the prayer. And the ulama say that if you are waiting for the prayer, and even though you are not in the masjid, but your heart is in the prayer, then you will be in the state of prayer. Sayyidina Shaykh Shihabuddin Sarwardi rahimahullah says that when such a person, one who thinks about salah, one is always thinking about the prayer, when he goes back to the masjid, meaning he has prayed his zuhur, after Zuhr, till Asr, his body was occupied in his worldly affairs, in his day-to-day activities.
And then when he went to pray his Zuhr prayer, Asr prayer in the masjid, the moment he says, Allahu Akbar, he will feel as if he has come out of one prayer and then he has started another prayer. Meaning one prayer was Zuhr, then the prayer, the time between Zuhr and Asr, that itself was a prayer, and now Asr is another prayer. So he prayed Zuhr, after Zuhr he was still praying. He was working, he was in his university, he was in his college, he was working in his dunya. He was probably doing something for his family members, for his children. He's into some sports or some dunyavi matters. But his heart is thinking about the prayer, he's in prayer. He's in salah. Because intizaru salah is salah. Waiting for the prayer is prayer. So Shaykh Shihabuddin Sohrawardi rahimahullah says, when you adopt this state, then when that person who has prayed Zuhr, when he will start Asr and say, Allahu Akbar, he will feel as if he has come from one prayer and now he has started another prayer. As if he is offering his salah. This hadith, Imam Bukhari narrates this. Akhrajahu al-Bukhari fi kitab al-azan babu man jalasa fil masjid wa akhrajahu muslimun fi kitab al-masajidi babu fadli salat al-jama'ah. Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari both narrate this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a sahih hadith, meaning the one who waits for the next prayer, it is as if he is praying. So this itself is another salah. Can you imagine this, brothers? 24 hours throughout the day you are in the state of salah. Now do you understand what I meant by when I said consider yourself Habib Jami, when I said that think that you are in the state of salah when you are not in the state of salah? You won't laugh at that now, would you? This is proven from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Consider yourself to be in the state of salah when you are not in the state of salah. You are not praying but you are still praying. Subhanallah. The ulama say, why do you have to do that? Do you know, even, no matter how sinful a person is, when he is praying salah, no matter how sinful a person is, when he is reading salah, he would not sin. He would not sin. Why? Because he thinks that he is in the presence of Allah Jalla wa'ala. He will say, okay, if I'm a sinful person, I will commit the sin after salah. But in salah, a believer, a Muslim will not sin. He will not sin. Because he says, I'm in the court of Allah, how can I sin? So when you begin to think that you're in salah when you're not in salah, then even then you will not sin. You will think I'm reading namaz. The way in namaz you will not sin, when you consider yourself to be in namaz, when you're not in namaz, then even then you will not sin. Because you will think, Allah Jalla wa'ala is observing me. I'm praying, I'm in salah. And what places you on the musalla? What places you on the musalla spiritually, on a spiritual musalla? Is just thinking about the prayer. Waiting in anticipation for the prayer. Anxiously waiting, impatiently waiting. Yearning for the time of salah to enter. When will the time of salah enter? Huh? And when we talk about the azan, then I will tell you what that excitement is all about. These are the points that will make you fall in love with the prayer. These are the points when you act upon them, you will feel hungry for the prayer. Subhanallah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that this person will be in the state of salah even though he is not praying. Even though he is not praying, but because he is waiting for the prayer. And the ulama say that if you are waiting for the prayer, and even though you are not in the masjid, but your heart is in the prayer, then you will be in the state of prayer. Sayyiduna Shaykh Shihabuddin Sarwardi rahimahullah says that when such a person, one who thinks about salah, one is always thinking about the prayer, when he goes back to the masjid, meaning he has prayed his zuhr, after zuhr, till asr, his body was occupied in his worldly affairs, in his day-to-day activities. And then when he went to pray his zuhr prayer, asr prayer in the masjid, the moment he says, Allahu Akbar, he will feel as if he has come out of one prayer and then he has started another prayer. Meaning one prayer was zuhr, then the prayer, the time between zuhr and asr, that itself was a prayer. And now asr is another prayer. So he prayed zuhr. After zuhr, he was still praying. He was working. He was in his university. He was in his college. He was working in his dunya. He was probably doing something for his family members, for his children. He's into some sports or some dunyavi matters. But his heart is thinking about the prayer. He's in prayer. He's in salah. Because intizaru salah is salah. Waiting for the prayer is prayer. So Shaykh Shihabuddin Sarwardi rahimahullah says, when you adopt this state, then when that person who has prayed zuhr, when he will start asr and say, Allahu Akbar, he will feel as if he has come from one prayer and now he has started another prayer. And why does this happen? Remember, if someone has prayed zuhr salah, after in zuhr salah he couldn't concentrate. Say that after learning these principles, you start acting upon them. And in zuhr prayer, you didn't know about these principles. After zuhr prayer, a lecture was delivered, and then you make niyyah that I will act upon these principles. During zuhr prayer, your body was present in salah. Your body was present in salah during zuhr prayer. But your ruh and your heart wasn't present. But then you made the niyyah that now from zuhr till asr, I will engage my heart. I will think about asr prayer. From zuhr till asr, I will think about my asr prayer. You make niyyah of that. And throughout that time, you're doing your worldly things, your day-to-day activities, daily things, dunya works, university, college, studies, sports, whatever you're doing. You are doing that. Your body is occupied in dunya, but your ruh and your heart is occupied in the remembrance of the prayer. So what has happened in zuhr prayer? Your body was occupied in the prayer, but your heart was in dunya. Your body was occupied in ibadah, but your heart was in dunya. The time between zuhr and asr, your ruh was occupied in ibadah, but your body was occupied in dunya. Yes? Is that clear? Zuhr, only body, no ruh, no heart. Heart is thinking about dunya. The time between zuhr and asr, during that time, body is occupied in dunya, ruh is occupied in ibadah, thinking about the prayer. Then when you will go to the masjid and you will offer your asr prayer, your body and ruh both will offer asr prayer with jamaat. Both brothers will be in jamaat. The ruh and the body both will pray salah with jamaat. The ruh and the body will both be together in jamaat. Do you see? That's a jamaat, that's a salah with jamaat. One is salah with jamaat when all humans get together. But it's probably bodies. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said there will come a time upon the ummah when you will not find a single person with khushu in prayer. Masajid will be full of namazis, but there will not be a single person who will have khushu in the prayer. Why? They are thinking about jamaat of people, but these are jamaat of bodies. He has not even established the jamaat within himself. He is not offering the prayer with jamaat. Why? It's only his body. But the real jamaat is when the body and ruh both pray by jamaat. And they both pray by jamaat. Subhanallah. Take another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this, remember, intizaru salah, it is mentioned in the Quran. Allahu Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَدَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَتَمَعًا. Allahu Akbar, in Surah Sajda, verse 16. Allahu Jalla wa Ala says, their sides forsake their beds. They call upon Allah with fear and hope. Meaning, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after Maghrib prayer, some Sahaba, they would be tired after Maghrib prayer. And Sahaba alayhi muridwan had to make extra effort, had to put more effort to pray the Isha prayer. And they would not go to their beds, they would not go to sleep, and they would wait till Isha prayer. And Allah Jalla wa Ala praises them. Allah says, their sides forsake their beds, they call upon Allah with fear and hope. Meaning, they remain in the house of Allah, they remain in the masjid from Maghrib till Isha. They do not want to go back to their house. Why? They may end up falling asleep. So they remain awake and Allah praises them in the Quran. So intizaru salah, waiting for the next prayer itself is mentioned in the Quran. تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَدَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفٌ وَتَمَعًا. Allah Jalla wa Ala praises those people. And the shan and nuzul of this Quranic verse is in a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أخر ليلة صلاة العشاء إلى شطر الليل ثم أقبل بوجهه بعدما صلى فقال صلى الناس ورقدوا ولم تزالوا في صلاة منذ انتظرتموها رواه البخاري. And there is another hadith on this subject. Sayyidina Anas radiyallahu ta'ala narrates, عن Anas radiyallahu ta'ala عنه أن هذه الآية تتجافى جنوبهم عن المداجع نزلت في انتظار الصلاة التي تدعى العتمة رواه الترمذي. This hadith is narrated by Imam al-Tirmizi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, akhrajahu al-Tirmizi fi kitab al-Tafsir. Imam Tirmizi narrates this in his kitab al-Tafsir, that Sayyidina Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu narrated that this Quranic verse, tatajafa junubuhum anil madaji, nazalat fi intizari salah. That this verse of the Quran, that they do not go to sleep, they remain away from their beds. Why? Intizaru salah, they're waiting for their prayer. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that this Quranic verse was revealed for the people who used to wait with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for salah, which is known as al-atama. Al-atama, what's al-atama? Students of deen should know. Al-atama is salatul isha. Al-atama is salatul isha. Tuda'a al-atama. The people used to wait from Maghrib till Isha with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the people who are praised in the Quran. So I am not making this up myself, that you are in Salah when you are waiting for Salah. I am giving direct references from the Quran and from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is what we will be implementing inshallah. What is that? From one prayer till the next prayer, we will keep thinking about the following prayer. We will be in the state of Salah when we are not praying. And that is something that we will act upon inshallah. And then Sayyidina Anas radiyallahu ta'ala narrates, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam akhara laylatan salatul ishai ila shatri layli summa akbala biwajhihi ba'dama salla faqala sallan nasu waraqadu walam tazalu fi salatin munzun tazartumuha rawahu al-Bukhari. Imam Bukhari narrates this. Akhrajahu al-Bukhari fi kitab al-azan babu man jalasa fil masjidi yantaziru salah wa fadlu al-masajid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala narrates, one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delayed his Isha prayer. One day what happened? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delayed his Isha prayer. The way we are delaying it. A lot of us are, we haven't prayed our Isha. So it's a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to delay Isha. Huh? Sometimes delaying Isha prayer is a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This usually happens to people. You know, salah time, if Maghrib is delayed a bit, jahil people have no knowledge of deen. What is the real time of? You have to ask scholars. You have to ask the ulama of the ummah. The ulama will tell you, sometimes delaying the prayer is a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what happened? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed Isha. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delayed Isha. Akhara ليلة صلاة العشاء إلى شطر الليل. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delayed صلاة العشاء. After Isha, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ثم أقبل بوجهه بعدما صلى. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned around to all the muqtadis. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, صلى الناس ورقدوا ولم تزالوا في صلاة. Some people have prayed, and then after praying Salatul Isha, they went to sleep. They got tired, they went to sleep. But you people are still in the state of Salah until you are waiting for the next Salah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised his companions. That some people they prayed, after they pray, after offering the prayer, they left and they went to sleep. But you people are still in the state of salah until you wait for the next salah. So all the time that when you're waiting for the next salah, you're still in the state of salah. There's some more ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on this subject, which we will cover inshallah. And remember, this is only one point at the moment. We've only discussed one point in the light of hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the forthcoming lectures inshallah, all 20 points will be covered. We will be going through all the 20, and each point, in each point inshallah, we will be giving Quranic verses and a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this will be another unique lecture on this subject. Another unique lecture on this subject. And inshallah, we are planning to publish books on these subjects. Like for the adab of the parents, the tazkiyah, we've given a detailed nizam of tazkiyah, a detailed nizam of concentration in salah, a detailed nizam of how to raise your children. All of these, inshallah, we will be publishing these books, inshallah, detailed books on these subjects. And everything that we are saying, it is in the light of Quran and the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So today, we've only covered one point, and even in that one point, there are three more ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which I will, inshallah, narrate them, inshallah, in the next lecture on this subject. And then, finally, just to conclude this, the benefit of this, as we have told you, that there comes a time, if you start acting upon this, what I want you to take with you tonight is the 6 points. 6 points that's easy to act upon. You start acting upon the 6 points. Learn the fiqh of salah, learn the tajweed of salah. As I explained in the beginning, a lot of people pray, but they pray as invalid. But if you act upon the 6 general things to think about during your salah, with the physical form of salah, if you implement them, inshallah ta'ala, you will begin to feel the nur of the prayer. And then other than that, with the 6 points, you start acting upon concentrating during wudu. That's easy. Think about the sins of the eyes and leaving from your body, sins of the hands, leaving with the water of the wudu, sins of the feet. And then when you clean your nose, now you know what to think about. Huh? We are not going to become like a sniffer dog. Huh? These khojis. Yes? We will become humans. We do not want to know about people. Min husn al-islami tarku ma la ya'ni. From the beauty of Islam is to leave that which does not concern you. That is the beauty of Islam. Don't think about and worry about other people. If it doesn't concern you, do not think about it. Do not talk about it. And one of the beauty of a human is that he covers the sins of other people. You know, if you can have such a big heart that you can hide the sins of other people, if you know the weaknesses of other people, do you know what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? The one who does satr, the one who hides and covers the sins of other people, Allah will hide his sins on the day of judgment. And Allah will never make him badnam in dunya. Fi dunya wa fil akhirah. Subhanallah. If you want to be saved from badnami and your heart has secrets of other people, do not discuss them with other people. This is a test. When women sit together, brothers sit together, the moment someone starts a conversation and you know something about someone so-and-so, you just feel the itch in your stomach. I have to say it. I have to tell people about his weakness. Cover the sins of other people. And what is the benefit of that? Your ta'weez is in your heart. Hide the sins of other people. Allah will protect you from badnami in dunya and in the hereafter. No matter what you know about people, you know, and you need to follow the footsteps of Baba Fariduddin Ganja Shakar rahmatullahi ta'ala. His heart was a khazana of secrets of other people. But he would never discuss them with people. So if you know, and this is the bimari in our community. A lot of people come to these gatherings. Why? For ta'wizat. Why? Because there's so much said against other people. If you know weaknesses of other people, hide them, cover them, do not talk to other people about them. One who is successful in doing that will succeed in dunya. No one will spread rumors against you. If someone does, Allah will purify you. Allah will protect you from the evil of dunya and from the evil eye of dunya. And in the hereafter, Allah will not disclose your sins. This is. So what is that when you clean your nose, you still think about that? Oh Allah, make tawbah from this. I will not look into other people's private matters. When you do masa of your ears, you think about not listening to backbiting, not listening to haram music. I will make tawbah. And you imagine the sins are being removed. When you do masa over your head, you think about not thinking about bad, not thinking about sinful acts. When you wash your feet, you think about the sins of your feet. So inshallah, that's tazkiyah. This is why we say all wudu is tazkiyah. You act upon these principles. Also, for the wird, I will give you a wird today that is about wudu. The wird is also about wudu. And what are the general principles are there that you can remember? Some things that I can... So one is 6 points. Physical form of salah. Then, general things to think about during wudu. Happiness in azan. Repeating the words of azan. These are easy things, simple things that you can all act upon. So you start with these, inshallah. And also, start from the 6 points. The most important point is learning the translation of salah. We will begin with translation of salah. We will learn the translation of salah. And when we read the translation of salah, we will follow the translation of salah. We will think about it when we are offering the prayer. We will work on that, inshallah. So also we will make niyyah tonight when we will pray our Isha. After Isha prayer, we will wait for Fajr prayer. Meaning, if when you go to sleep, make niyyah with the jazbah. Oh Allah, I will wake up for Fajr. Oh Allah, I will wake up for Fajr. I make niyyah and create the happiness and think about the Fajr time when I will go. Not that I will feel lazy. Someone will wake me up. Someone will say, get up, get up, get up, jaldi, jaldi. So and so, get up, it's namaz time. And then I won't wake up. And I will say, okay, let someone else make wudu first. Or let so and so make wudu first. Shibli will say, no, Mirab will read namaz first. Mirab will say, no, let Simab go and read namaz first. No, you will get up first. And then you will have the jazbah that I will do it first. Yes? That jazbah, that happiness, the moment someone wakes you up, you will get up and you will make wudu straight away. You will feel that happiness, that excitement that the namaz time has entered. So we make the niyyah of that when we go to sleep. And the one who will die in that state will die as a mu'min, as a believer. Subhanallah. Today's wird, right? Today's wird, inshallah, it's a simple wird. Hadith, it is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is in Kanz al-Ummal and also Al-Havil al-Fatawil al-Suyuti rahimahullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the one who recites Surah Al-Qadr once after wudu, one who recites Surah Al-Qadr, what is Surah Al-Qadr? Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. The one who recites this Surah Al-Qadr once after wudu, in the hereafter, he will be raised with Siddiqeen. Siddiqeen. Great awliya Allah. One who makes a habit, he will be from the Siddiqeen. So do you make niyyah inshallah? After wudu, you will recite Surah Al-Qadr. And if you haven't memorized it, memorize it as soon as possible. This is a big soda, big karabar. There's no loss. Take some time out. It'll take you probably 1 hour maximum if you have a very weak memory to learn Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. So memorize it once. Memorize it. And if you read it once after wudu, in the hereafter you will be raised with Siddiqeen. And the one who recites it twice. The one who recites it twice. Recites what? Kul huwa Allahu ahad. If you say kul huwa Allahu ahad, then I won't say inna anzalna, then I will say inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji. So recites what? Surah Al-Qadr. What is Surah Al-Qadr? Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. The one who recites it twice, he will gain the reward of shuhada. If you recite it once after wudu, then you will gain the reward. You will be counted as the Siddiqeen. And if you recite it twice, you will be from the Shuhada, from the martyrs. Subhanallah. And listen to this now. The one who recites it thrice, the one who recites it 3 times. How long does it take? 2 minutes to recite Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. And if you recite it 3 times, in the hereafter, Allah will raise you with His prophets. Allahu Akbar. Allah will raise you with his prophets, with Anbiya. The one who recites Surah Al-Qadr 3 times after wudu. Allah bless you all. Allah accept all that we have talked about, and Allah bless us. Allah bless us with sharh of sadr, with the opening of our hearts, so that we can act upon these teachings of Islam, we can implement them, and inshallah we make niyyah that we will act upon these principles. And what is the benefit of these? If you make a habit of these, you will fall in love with the prayer, and then there will come a time when the prayer will pray for you. When the prayer will pray for you. When salah will make du'as for you. We will act upon this inshallah ta'ala. Allah bless you all. Jazakumullahu khaira wa ahsan al-jaza wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Sallallahu ala muhammadin al-nabiyyil ummiyyi wa ala.